Welcome to Anchor Baptist Church. Good to see each and every one of you. Hope that you've had a great week.
We've got the rowdy group today, Mike.
I tell you what, it's tough sometimes. We're going to have to start doing a countdown or a ball of the symphony.
Let's see if we can get their attention this way. If you would please fasten your seatbelts. The exits are here and here. In case of an emergency during the message.
Mask will fall from the ceiling.
The mask will fall, yes. All right, you're good.
Even the oxygen's flowing even though the bag isn't. Yeah, speaking of hot air. Well, good morning. Hope that you've had a great week. Great to see each and every one of you here this morning, especially if you're with us for the very first time. I'm going to welcome our visitors and let you know it's our honor and privilege to have you with us. Ask you to do us one favor and one favor only. We're not going to point you out, but you will find on the table out in the hallway a guest card. Take a moment when you go out this afternoon on your way. Fill out that guest card and leave it sitting right there on the table. We'd love to have a record of your visit with us. And if you do get intrigued with Anchor, we'd like to know more about it. Leave a little message on that card. We'll have somebody schedule a time that's convenient with you. They'll come out and answer your questions. Hopefully we'll welcome you as one of our new members. As you can see, I have got a stage that runs from one end to the other with multicolored book bags. And I tell you what, if you want to test your strength and get a workout, come pick up one of these things. They are jam-packed and loaded. Congratulations. Thank y'all so much. It was 100% fully funded. It is a backpack full of school supplies, and we're going to help a lot of youngsters get started off this year.
That wouldn't have those bags like that otherwise.
That would not have those bags
thank
like that.
Thank you, ladies ministry. You guys are awesome.
And speaking of ladies ministry.
All right. Sign-up is still out in the back. The deadline to sign up for the retreat is next week. So please, if you have not signed up yet, please sign up in the back. And that is it.
All right.
So September the 6th, we're going to start our new ministry here at Anchor. And it's called The Middle because it's in the middle of the week. And it's our little stepping stone till the next Sunday. And it's going to be Wednesdays. And we're going to have dinner here in the sanctuary at 6 o'clock. And then we'll have different groups that will meet, three different groups that will meet at 6:45. We will have our children's ministry, which this one's awesome. It's from our VBS ministry, and it's called the So-and-So Show. And it's with the two guys, and those of you who are leaders with the children's ministry, you'll know it's these guys are really funny. So that's for our children. So for everyone else, you will come in on September 6th. Well, actually before, you'll decide. There's a sign-up sheet right out in the hallway. And you'll either put Jim, Mac, or Kevin on it because each of us will be doing, it's sort of like a three-ring circus, but I don't know if that makes us the clowns or the elephants. But you pick which ring you want to be a part of for 12 weeks. And on September 6th, it starts, you'll come in and you'll have spaghetti or you'll have pizza or whatever we're having for that week for dinner. And then you'll go to your group, and that group will last for 12 weeks. Jim is doing one called Faith Fit, a spiritual workout for believers. Mac is doing one called Bills and Believers, Uncommon Sense About Money, and then I'm doing one called Emotions and the God Who Made Them, and it's about managing emotions from God's Word. And so you just go out in the hall, it's just one sheet, and you just write your name and your phone number, and you write Jim or Kevin or Mac, whichever one of these that you want to be a part of. You will come in every week starting September 6th. We'll come in, we'll have dinner together, all in the sanctuary, and then we'll break off to our groups, and then as soon as the group is over, the groups will last about 35 minutes, we head home. And that's the deal with that. So if you have any questions about it, come see me or Mac or Jim. And then tonight.
Tonight,
doors open at 6 o'clock. Bonnie English family will be here. Mac and I interviewed Bonnie on the radio on Friday. It's Michael English's brother. He's got a great ministry. And I'm telling you, this is going to be a neat concert, I believe, Mac, for a couple reasons. Number one, their harmonies are amazing because they're all family. You can't beat DNA harmonies. But the other thing is, they really do a worship ministry, and they really minister to people. Their music kind of speaks for itself. And then the guy over here on the left, this is Sean English. Sean is the youngest member of the family. He's Bonnie's son. And I'm telling you, he sings like Michael English, and he looks like Michael, and it's really a cool ministry that they have. But he's a great singer in general. He's recorded in Nashville, and just Bonnie has worked with the Anchormen, with the Kingsmen, with the Gaither Vocal Band. He sang with all these folks.
So he's been around for a long time. Been around the block. Matter of fact, his family's been around for a long time, is what he had told us
about. 60 years. The Singing Samaritans, the Singing Americans, all these different people. So anyway, that's tonight. The concert's free. We'll take up a love offering for him, and that's that. So concert will begin right at 7 o'clock. So if you want a seat, and I already heard that there's folks coming from out of town to see it, I would love it. It would be cool if you could be at this concert tonight, if you want to be encouraged. They're funny, and their ministry is really awesome. They sing great. So 7 o'clock tonight, and it's free.
All righty. And as COVID is still kind of prevalent, we're going to let you kind of make your choice this morning. But we would like everybody to stand up. If you're comfortable meeting and greeting, do so. If not, just turn around, wave at somebody, give them a big smile, let them know it's good to be in God's house this morning. Then join us as we begin our praise and worship and song.
Let's sing together.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord our God. You reign forever. Our hope, our strong defense. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. As we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Our strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord our God. You reign forever, our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the ever. Everlasting God, you do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. Lord, you comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles.
I'd really like for all of you, if you would please, to read this verse with me. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. Everlasting God,
not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak, Lord, you comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles.
Gone, Lord, and we just can't thank you enough for that. Lord, we ask you to please bless these tithes and offering. Let it go to your kingdom, whether it be local or throughout the world, Lord. We ask all of these things in your precious name. Amen.
You may be seated. You stand with us.
In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16 through 18, we find the words written, "For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel and with the trumpet call of God. Then the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words."
One day when heaven's filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. Dwelt, became flesh, and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living, he loved me, dying, he saved me, buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day they led him to Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. And let the nations stretch out his hand and took the nails for me. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Learning, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious day. One day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he arose over death he had conquered. Now is ascended, my Lord evermore. Death could not hold him, the grave could not keep him. Rising again, living he loved me. Dying he saved me. Buried he carried my sin far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming. Oh, glorious day. Glorious day. One day the trumpet will sound for his coming. One day the skies with his glories will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved ones bring me. My Savior Jesus is mine. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious day. Sing it again. Oh, glorious day. Glorious day. Oh, glorious day.
You may be seated.
Good morning. Isn't it good to be together in God's house this morning? It's good to see all of you. I want to just talk just for a minute about this, what we got going on up front here in these backpacks. It was mentioned earlier, and I wanted to just reiterate how much I appreciate the ladies' ministry sort of heading this up, and Kevin briefly mentioned it, that these are not just backpacks full of school supplies for children to go to school. They are for kids that would normally not have this to go to school next week. They normally wouldn't have this. There would be some other way they'd have to try to get by. And so these backpacks are going to children that are in a difficult situation in life. And so if I just want to couple with what has been done here, and it was mentioned too, this was completely by donation. This was all was donated by folks in the church, and it just does my heart good, and it should do all of us good to understand that we have that kind of heart for You know, our children are in trouble in a world that we live in today, and just every little bit. So what I'm going to ask you to do is not only, I know maybe this will seem kind of silly to you, but I think it's on my heart, and I want to share this with you. As you're looking towards the front, if you need to stand up, you stand up and look too. I want you to find a particular backpack, and I want you to pray for the hands that backpack's going to go into. That home, that family, that child, that it will go far more than just school supplies, but that they'll know that somebody cared and that God will just open their hearts to that. So I appreciate if you would do that as make that a matter of prayer. And speaking of prayer, I want to encourage you, beginning September 1st, Anchor is going to be praying and focused on prayer for 30 days. It's our first, and I hope it to be a regular occurrence, a regular event of 30 days of prayer. We're going to have a lot going on during that 30 days of prayer. There's a prayer calendar out there on the table if you want to take one of those and follow along with our focused prayer throughout the month of September, those 30 days. Just want to encourage you, and maybe you already have an effective prayer life, and maybe you already are there. Many of us are not. And we need to be encouraged, and we need to, prayer is so vitally important to who we are and our relationship with God. And so I encourage you to be a part of our 30 days of prayer and tell others about it. And let's just be a praying people. September, we got a lot going on, a new ministry here at the church on September 6th, right? September 6th, and that's already been mentioned. So, but we'd love to have you come and be a part of that as well. Let's pray real quick before we get to the message this morning. God, thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to gather like this. God, we know that across our world that we live in, God, this is not an opportunity that everyone gets. And God, we are so blessed to be in this situation where you have gathered us together just like this. And God, I ask you, Lord, just to take your word today. And that, God, that you would place it deep in our hearts, God, that you would just cause it to grow there. And it would change us. And then, God, we'd be drawn ever closer to you. God, you promised in your word that if we would draw close to you, you would draw close to us. And we want to do that with your word today. And, God, we pray that for each one of us, God, that it will be special and it will be moving and it will be life-changing. As your word always is. God, we love you so much. Help us now to be a conduit to deliver your word. It's in the precious holy name of Jesus we pray. And amen. This morning we're continuing our series in the book of John, the gospel according to John. And we'll be looking at beginning chapter 5 this week. And encourage you to follow along with us in John chapter 5. There's several verses to read this morning. So if you'll bear with me on the length, I think that we need all of it in order to share the message this morning. So let's look to God's word. In John chapter 5, beginning with verse 1. After these things, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is in Jerusalem by the sheep gate, a pool, which is called in the Hebrew Bethesda, having five porticos. And in these lay a multitude of those who were sick, blind, lame, and withered, waiting for the moving of the waters. For the angel of the Lord went down at a certain season into the pool and stirred up the water. Whoever then first, after stirring of the water, stepped in was made well from whatever disease with which he was afflicted. A man was there who had been ill for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had already been a long time in that condition, he said to him, "Do you wish to get well?" And the sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up, but while I am coming, another steps down before me." And Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up your pallet, and walk." And immediately the man became well and picked up his pallet and he began to walk. Now it was the Sabbath on that day, so the Jews were saying to the man who was cured, "It is the Sabbath, and it is not permissible for you to carry your pallet." But he answered them, and he who made him well was the one who said to me, pick up your pallet and walk. And they ask him, who is the man who said to you, pick up your pallet and walk? But the man who was healed did not know who it was, for Jesus had slipped away while there was a crowd in that place. And afterward, Jesus found him in the temple and said to him, behold, you have become well. Do not sin anymore, so that nothing worse happens to you. The man went away and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had made him well. And for this reason, the Jews were persecuting Jesus because he was doing these things on the Sabbath. But he answered them, my Father is working until now, and I myself am working. In this passage of Scripture, we're going to talk about this man in just a moment, but I was thinking, you know, as men, as women, as people, we are looking in all directions for help. Well, we need help. We all do. We wait on something to happen. We follow the news. We follow everything around us, waiting for that something to happen that will change our life and give us that big break that we're looking for. We find ourselves just focused, waiting for the next latest and greatest thing to come along the way, for the next leader to be elected, for the next entertainment to come along, the next something that will just change our lives and give us contentment and give us peace and give us some sort of satisfaction in this life that we live, waiting for that next latest and greatest that will change our lives. And then when something happens, something happens in our world, something, our culture shift, something happens in our world, then we finally, you know, and people are becoming happy and they're becoming content, and then it looks as if, because nothing's changed for us, it looks as if we're getting left out. It looks as if we didn't get in on the last big break. It didn't happen for us. Everybody else gets what they need. Everybody else gets what they want. But here I am sitting. Where's my big break? Where's my opportunity? How come it never breaks my way? How come my family never finds themselves in such a situation that we see so many people being successful? How come we never? How come I never? When's my time? I see it all around me. I see people being successful. I see people gaining material things and bank accounts growing. And I see, success and power and authority. I see it all around me. When's my big break? When's my turn? When do I get to be better? When do I need to be and get to be successful? Well, could it be that we're looking and focused on the wrong thing to bring us our big break? Church, it is so easy to find ourselves hosting our own pity party. See, to have a pity party, you got to host it. There's nobody going to call you up and say, I'm inviting some of your friends over today, and I want you to come over and we're going to have a pity party with you, because we feel sorry. That's just not going to happen. If we're having a pity party for ourselves, we're hosting it. And if we look around us, sometimes we find ourselves hosting our own pity party. Church, it's so easy to find ourselves in that situation when we get to our situation where it's a, oh, woe is me syndrome. Have you heard of that? It's a syndrome, and it's real. It's real. There's no medication for it. You get that, did you? There's no medication for it. You can't go to the doctor and say, Doc, oh, woe is me. What's he going to do? Again, it's you, right? It's you hosting that. It's you developing an attitude of, oh, woe is me. Look how everything else is successful around me. Look how people are doing so good. I look at my neighbors. I look down the street. I look at other people, and their careers are just advancing. And I look at other people. They just seem like they never have a worry in the world. But me, I'm still here waiting for my big break. Waiting for the right person to come along. Waiting for the right thing to come along. Now that's where we find this man by the pool of Bethesda. This man has been without strength. He's been sick or whatever his ailment was. We don't know that. But he's been, this is a 38-year process. He's been in this mess, in this tough spot for 38 years. He's in a bad way and been in a bad way for a while. He sat there staring at the water, focused. Focused, because what if it stirs? I've got to be ready. So he's focused on nothing but staring at the water to stir in hopes that some way, somehow, he could be the first one to roll in and his strength would be restored. That's his goal in life. He gets up in the morning, and we don't know whether, and we'll mention this again in a moment, we don't know whether he camped there, whether he kind of lived there, or whether he was carried from his home to there and spent the days there. We don't know that exactly, but he spent a lot of time there. But that's what he did. That was his life. His life was focused on something that might give him a big break. It might give him that thing that he needed. Now, some say that these were springs that were fed. These pools were fed by springs. And occasionally the water would be stirred by these springs. These underground springs would feed these pools and it would cause a movement into the water. And some folks even, you know, in their research and studies said that, and this is probably where the whole idea of the healing came from, was that as that spring was being fed, that it carried with it a lot of minerals. And the minerals in that water, they said that there were so much minerals in the water that the water appeared to be even red at times. And so they thought that it had some kind of medicinal purposes, and so there was some kind of healing and make that and make them feel better about what was going on. That was where this man was. He was putting all of his hope, and yet time after time, as years go by, he diligently watched for an opportunity that never happened. Worked on the same thing every day, but it never happened. His life never changed. He was never better. For 38 years, he comes to this pool every day, waiting for that stir of the water and hoping that he can get in first. So he was looking for his big break in life. What a waste. Waiting on something that would never come. Waiting on that thing that would never bring peace. It would never bring joy. It would have been a miserable, miserable life. Now, I know that the tradition of that whole healing in these pools, it came from somewhere. No doubt that this man had seen others healed, but consider what's going on here. This is not at all any, there's no biblical precedent to people being healed in this way. First in? Have we ever seen God heal people? And okay, first one gets here, I'll heal them. He's never put that kind of stipulation on healing. But church, there are those that are sick. And those that are sick because they believe they are sick. You can turn on your TV, turn it to the right channel, or the wrong channel probably in this case. And you'll see many people in line to come forward for a man at the front to heal them. I'm going to tell you a story. Many years ago, when I was a young man, and I say many years ago, when I was a young man, I went to Army basic training. And I met another young man there, and he knew that I was a believer. I don't know whether I said the right thing or what, but somehow the conversation got to the point where he knew that I was a believer and that I trusted God. And I believed in God, and I believed in Christ. And so we got in this conversation, and he was telling me why he did not believe. And I'm trying to share with him why I do believe, and he's returning that with why he doesn't believe. And you know, finally question, I said, why don't you believe? And he said this, He said, I was on the payroll. I said, what do you mean I was on the pay? You were on the payroll. He said, I traveled with a faith healer who claimed that God could heal you if you paid for your ticket into the building and you got chosen, then you could be healed. He said, I worked for him. And he said, we traveled all over the country, weekend after weekend. He said, some weeks, one of my legs was shorter than the other. And so I went forward and he straightened it out. He said, some weeks, I had a problem with my hearing. And so he made the hearing better. And some weeks, and he just went on and on. He said, I was even assigned what ailment I was going to have at the next thing. And so it caused everybody to come to these things. And he said, that's such a lie. He said, I'm not proud that I was a part of it. He said, but there's no healing in faith. He said, people will believe whatever they want to believe. He also told me that he worked for a psychic hotline. What was her name? Chloe? Miss Chloe? Miss? Nope, that's it. Anyway, he worked for an organization like that. And he said, I take phone calls. He said, do you know? He said, I could ask 5 questions of you. And for the next 30 minutes, I can tell you everything you ever wanted to know about yourself. He said, it's a process. He said, people will believe anything. He said, so I don't believe any of that stuff. I don't believe anything. You see how Satan works? People believe in what they want to believe. There are many manuscripts that don't even include this part of the scripture about the water being stirred and all that. But regardless, what we see is John make the point that this man was in a bad way. And he was looking in the wrong direction for his big break. He was looking to something that was never going to happen to satisfy him. And again, we find Jesus, just like he did for the lady at the well, and in other instances, again, we find Jesus who would seemingly be going out of his way, but Jesus showed up in this man's life and ask him a question. A very simple question. He asked him in Scripture in verse 6. In verse 6 he says, when Jesus saw him lying there and he knew that he had already been a long time in that condition, he said to him, do you wish to get well? Boy, on the surface, that seems like a silly question, doesn't it? I've been laying here for 38 years. I can't get in the water. I can't make anything happen here. And you're asking me, do I wish to get well? It seems like a silly question to a man that's been laying there for almost 40 years. But this question was huge. What Jesus was asking him is, how is this working out for you? Do you want to get well? Can we add to the question here? Do you want to get well? Do you want to keep staying here and doing this? Or do you want to get well? The question, for just a moment, instilled a little bit of hope in this man. Because remember, you remember the conditions of the pool? He had to see it stir, right? And then be the first one in. So you know in this man, then we know that he was laying there because he had a bed with him. He was laying there and he was staring into the water. He was staring into the water, waiting for just that moment when it stirred. And then Jesus says, do you want to get well? And just for a moment, Jesus had his attention. And he turns to listen to Jesus. Could there be another way? Must have been what in this man's mind. Could there be another way? This man responds, not with, yes, I want to be healed. He didn't respond with, no, I got this. He says, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is stirred. I have no man. Oh, woe is me. If everyone around me would just do what they need to do, then I'd be fine. woe is me. I can't do it for myself. So woe is me. I need somebody. I need somebody. If a man would just do what they're supposed to do, if the people around me would just do what they're supposed to be doing, I would be okay. He didn't say, yes, I want to be healed. Or, no, I got this. He said, woe is me. I can't find anybody to help me. I would be happy if those around me would just do what I want them to do. I would have peace if others, some man, would just do something for me. I could move forward if a man would just do it for me. What a pity party. And is that not the culture that we live in? If someone would just do it for me, if somebody would just help me, church, listen to this. And if you don't grasp anything else out of the message this morning, write this down, carry it in your pocket, believe it and trust it. There is no man able to do what only Jesus can do. Amen? No man can do it. No man can do what only Jesus can do. The question would change this man's life. This question would be much deeper and more powerful than this man could have imagined. This man did not know it yet, but he was having a conversation with God. He was talking to the one, the only one, that was able to do what he said he could do. And the question before us is, do you want your big break? Do you want to get well? Do you want to get well? Or are we content day after day to keep looking to a world that is falling apart around us and in chaos? Or are we going to keep looking for that world to stir? Do we lay around waiting for a man to make our lives right, full of joy and peace? Do you wish to get well? What a powerful question. What seemed like just a silly question just a moment ago, now you see the power of this question. Do you wish to get well? Because I see what you've been doing is not working for you. Do you want to get well? Do you really want change in your life? And Jesus responds this time not with a question, but with a command. He says, get up, pack up, and walk. Jesus tells this man, get up. Laying around, depending on what man can do, and depending on tradition, was not going to help him at all. Jesus said, get up. Leave the pity party. Exit the pity party. Get out of the pity party. Get out of your own self-pity. This man had been laying here for nearly 40 years, and he was still laying there, feeling sorry for himself because no man would roll him into the water when the water stirred, who we don't even know would really cure him or not. He just keeps laying there. Get out of the pity party. Quit feeling sorry for yourself. But Jesus said, get up. And there is no doubt that Jesus gave him the strength to do it. He couldn't do that on his own. Evidently, he couldn't do that on his own. Church, can we not see that laying around feeling sorry for ourselves and depending on man is not the life that God has for us? It's not. God wants to give us joy, peace, unexplainable peace, unspeakable joy. God wants us to live our lives. Our big break is when God sent His only begotten Son, Jesus, to pay our sin debt and redeem us back to a relationship with God. That's our big break. We've had our big break. Our big break is an encounter with Jesus when God convicted us and drew us to Himself and had Him place our salvation through His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. That's our big break. That's our ticket to peace and joy and satisfaction. And it doesn't matter our circumstance in life if we have an encounter with Jesus. We have a relationship with God through Christ. How can we ever feel sorry for ourselves? What do we feel sorry about? Well, you don't know, Pastor. I'm in a mess. I've got this going on, and so-and-so don't like me anymore, and somebody else over here, they're talking about me, and I'm just upset about that. And I'm going to go over here, and I know as soon as I go in the grocery store, then I'm going to see so-and-so, and you know what? I don't know. I just lost my job, too. I don't know where my income is. You know, COVID is just rampant where I'm at, and I don't know where I'm going to go. I don't know where I'm going to turn to. You know why? I'm just about to the point. I'm just going to sit down at home and just die. I'm just going to host my own pity party. We do live in a difficult time. We do have difficult things going on around us. But how can we feel sorry for ourselves when the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords came and gave his life on the cross of Calvary to pay our eternal sin debt, that we can have an eternal relationship with him through Christ, and he's coming back? How can we feel sorry for ourselves when we're trusting Christ for everything in our life? And Jesus heals us. Jesus says, get up. I don't think he said it softly either. I think he told him, get up. That was a command. There was no options there. He said, get up. And then he says, pack up your stuff. Get your pallet. Pack up your stuff. Now, we do not know if this man, again, we don't know if he's camped out by the pool or just came there daily. I kind of think that because you never know when the water's going to stir, that he was probably there most of the time. Probably living there. Jesus says, pack up your stuff. This man has spent the better part of 40 years hanging out here, hoping to get his big break from a tradition. But Jesus tells him not only to get up, but he tells him to pack up his things. Why would he tell him to pack up his things? Church, because he wasn't going back there. He told him to get up. Pack up your things. You don't need that spot anymore. You're leaving this spot. Is that not God's message to us? Get up. Quit feeling sorry for yourself. Pack up all your things and let's move. You don't need this spot anymore. You don't need this feel sorry. You don't need this woe is me spot anymore. You have me. You have eternal life, you have hope, you have peace, you have joy. You have satisfaction in me. You don't need this spot anymore. Pack your stuff up, come on. Get up and pack up your stuff. There would be no more need for his place at the pool. There would be no need for him to wallow in self-pity when you have a relationship with God through Christ. There's no need for that. When Jesus heals, it changes our residency. I'm not talking about geographically. I'm talking about it changes where we live our lives. When God heals us spiritually, it puts us in a different place. It puts us in a different mindset, a different heart place. And we don't need that old place any longer. There's no reason to save our spot. Jesus tells him, get up. Pack up your stuff and start walking. Remember, that was the whole command. He said, get up, pick up your pallet, and walk. Start walking. The man did not even know who Jesus was yet, but Jesus told him to start walking. Jesus tells him, this is not where you should be. Note that at this point, he has already healed him because he can get up and he can pack up his things. But now Jesus tells him to move away from what he has looked to for help for almost 4 decades. Church, Jesus is telling us as well, it's time to walk away from all the things that we keep holding out our hope for to change our lives. We're looking to get our big break from the things of the world. Recently, the lottery got close to $1 billion, right? I think I'm right. A lot of money. There's a lot of people holding out hope for that. Yeah, sorry about that. That's where their hope was. And I'm just using that for an illustration, but sometimes it's where our hope lies, isn't it? Getting lucky. I'm not sure if anybody won it. Maybe you know or not. It may have been you. And if it was, don't forget that a tithe of $1 billion is $100 million. Winning the lottery sure would change your life, wouldn't it? It would change the things around you. You may have a bigger house, nicer car. You may not have to go to work every day. It would change some things around you, wouldn't it? Come on, shake your head, yes. It would change things. That's no lie. It would change some things. And every change it would make would be a temporary change in your life, because it will not change your eternity. All the money in the world, stored up, packed up, nice and neat in its piles, sitting in the bank, will not change your eternity, not one bit. And I'll tell you something else it won't change. It won't change your heart, except maybe for the bad. It won't change, it won't give you peace. Have you ever, I'm telling myself right now, have you ever seen those documentaries that follow people who have won the lottery and got all this money all of a sudden? They end up in jail. Or they end up losing all of it. It's because all the money in the world can't change your heart. Only Christ, crucified, risen again, the gospel, the good news of Christ, will change you eternally. Only that. Jesus asked the man the question, "Do you wish to get well?" The man tells Jesus that his hope is in tradition and man. And Jesus heals him up, tells him to get up, pack up, and walk away from that. And guess where the man walks to? The next thing we see is Jesus meeting him at the temple. Imagine that. He goes to the temple. And obviously Jesus did more than just heal the man's physical issues, because he said this. When Jesus talked to him at the temple, he says, "You have become well." You're well now. You have no reason to feel sorry for yourself. You have no reason to hang out and look to man for answers. You have no reason to look at tradition. You're well now. And then he says, "Don't sin anymore." See, the man's problem was not physical all along. The man's problem was sin. He says, "Don't sin anymore." Jesus takes the whole narrative of a crippled man, and he brings it all the way to the point where he tells him, "You are well now. Don't sin anymore." You remember the lady caught in adultery in Scripture? And she was caught. I mean, she was guilty. And all the men, they gathered around, they were going to stone her. And they had picked up stones, and one by one, as Jesus, and I don't know what he was writing on the ground, but Jesus began to write on the ground. I kind of think, this is just me now, I just kind of think maybe he was revealing some stuff about these fellows that they didn't want other people to know. Maybe. I don't know. But one by one, they drop their stones and walk away. But here's the really thing that gets left out of that story. And that's really cool. That's really cool that Jesus, he says, "Neither do I condemn thee." And then he says this. He says, "Go and sin no more." He didn't condone the sin the lady had did to put her in this situation. Jesus never condoned sin. He didn't condone the sin of the men around her that were getting ready to cast the stones. He said, "Go and sin no more." The problem was not physical. The problem was spiritual. The problem was sin. And our problems that we have in life, we look around waiting for our big break. Our problem is not we don't have enough money. Our problem is that we don't live in the right place. Our problem is not that we don't have the right this or the right that. Our problem is sin. And the only answer to our sin is Christ crucified, risen again. It's our salvation that we have in Christ. When he sees the man at the temple, he tells him, "You are well, don't sin anymore." Listen, a wise preacher once said this: sin will take you further than you wanted to go and keep you there longer than you wanted to stay. We are living in a time, and it's always been, I suppose, that man is looking to man for answers. If we can just get the right leaders, if we can just get the right break in life, then we'll be there. And we'll have peace and we can be happy. We've exhausted countless hours debating and promoting and defending man and his traditions, because that is where we see the solution. That's where we're looking for answers. That's where we're looking for our big break, as in man and his answers and his solutions. And we spent countless hours following it and looking to it and looking to see how it's going to change our lives. But it never does. The answer is Jesus. Comparatively, how much effort and resources do we put in to following Jesus? To looking to him for answers. To looking to his word for guidance and direction. I'm just going to throw this out, okay? I'm going to stand to the side. Maybe these people over here don't have bigger rocks as these people over there. How much time do we spend seeking God's word and direction in our lives compared to the news channel on television? How much time do we spend seeking direction from God versus seeking direction from man? How much time are we spending? How much of our lives are we willing to spend 38 years looking for help from something that's never going to come? That's never going to give us the answer, that's never going to give us peace, is never going to give us satisfaction in our hearts? Or are we going to look to Jesus and look to his word? I'm going to close before I get in trouble here. In our text this morning, there's something else to note. And this is really a whole message to itself, but I think it's important to bring, especially to the close of this message. All this happened on the Sabbath. You remember that part of the story? It all happened on the Sabbath. That wasn't by accident. Jesus went there on the Sabbath to heal this man. Jesus doesn't do things just God doesn't do things just out of reaction, just out of man. God doesn't base what he does based on what man is doing. God is sovereign. And it all happened on the Sabbath because it was God designed to happen on the Sabbath. This man was questioned because he was carrying his stuff on the Sabbath. Well, God had told him to carry it on the Sabbath. Jesus told him, pick up your pallet and walk. And the Jewish leaders at the time, they caught him doing it. And they said, why are you doing that? He said, because the man told me to. Because the guy that healed me, the reason why I can walk, you know, he told me to do it. Church, Jesus had broken no laws of God. He never did. All throughout Scripture, you check it. He never broke one single law that God gave. Do you know why he was here in this place to begin with? Why he came by here? It says, it doesn't tell us which one, but it tells us that he came there because it was the time of the feast. He didn't tell us which feast it was, but those feasts were established by God in the Old Testament, in the Old Testament law, and Jesus was following the law. He was there because of the feast. Jesus never, ever broke the law of God. But the law of the Sabbath does not prohibit doing good on the Sabbath. And Jesus teaches that the Sabbath was given for man. It was given for us for a time of rest. That's what Sabbath means. That was the example they give us. But it nowhere does God teach us or tell us that we're not to do anything on the Sabbath, but it is a day set aside for worship and for concentrated rest in Him. No laws were broken. Jesus was only guilty of breaking the tradition in favor of truth. But He closes this section with saying this. He says, I myself am working. My Father is working until now, and I myself am working. What was He telling us? When He says that, what's He saying? He's saying that He is God. This incident right here with this man getting caught carrying his pallet on the Sabbath set the wheels in motion for the persecution of Christ. Throughout the rest of the story, throughout the rest of the gospel, you're going to see the persecution and the rejection of Christ escalate from this one point, because the Jewish leaders at that time were realizing who He was. We've got to stop this. He's gaining more and more influence. He's claiming now to be, now we got Him. Now we got Him. He broke the Sabbath. Now we know. Now we got Him. We got something to persecute Him about. And it just escalates from there, leading all the way up to the cross. Jesus was only guilty of breaking tradition in favor of the truth. Jesus came to seek and to save the lost, not to preserve the traditions of man. Here's the question this morning that's before us. Are you this morning laying beside the pool of Bethesda? That word Bethesda, it means place of mercy. And we see God exercise His mercy on this man. Are you this morning laying beside the pool of Bethesda, waiting on a tradition or waiting on a man to change your life? Waiting for your big break? Looking for man or culture or something in this world to do something so that you can feel better? When Jesus asked this question, do you want to be well? Get up, pack up your things, and walk with Jesus. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, God, I thank You so much for this opportunity from Your Word. And God, we know in Your Scripture, Lord, we're going to see throughout Your Word how this began a persecution that would lead ultimately to Your perfect sacrifice on the cross. They would find a reason, a made-up, mocked reason, Lord, to crucify You. God, we know that You were crucified on our behalf because of our sin. God, we thank You so much for the perfect and powerful plan of salvation in our life. God, I pray that if there's anyone here in this room or listening to this broadcast, either right now or later, God, that Your Word would find lodging in our hearts, bring us to conviction, that we would get up and leave our pity parties and walk with You and trust You. It's in Your holy and wonderful name we pray. And amen.
Would you stand with us? If you'd like to accept Christ today, maybe you'd like to become a member of Anchor Church, or you need prayer for something, Jim will be up front for you as we sing this song.
presence to worship and to praise, to share in your word. But Father, as we scatter, we just ask that you would use us, help us to take what we've learned and heard today, apply it to our lives, but Father, be willing and ready to share it with those out there in the world who don't know that there is someone who wants to help them in their times of need, and that person is Jesus. Father, help us to be what you would have us to be, do what you would have us to do, but help us to remember to honor, glorify you, and that all the honor and glory and praise for it belongs to you and you alone. We thank you again for each time that you bring us together, Father. We look forward to being together again in your presence as your children. You be praised, honored, and glorified in Jesus' precious name. Amen.